Welcome to EPG Patashala. I'm Dr. Shanti, visiting faculty Vivekananda Institute for Leadership Development, freelance social science researcher based in Mysore. This module is part of Education and Society course. Here we are going to learn about Mahatma Gandhi's philosophy of education and its social implications. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, popularly known as Mahatma Gandhi to all of us, was born in Porbandar, Gujarat on 2nd of October 1869. Gandhi's exposure to the situations of people in South Africa taught him much more about life than actually the formal system of education to which he was exposed to in the classrooms. It is this understanding of life which gave shape to the views that he held on education. To understand Gandhi's views on education, it is very important for us to clearly perceive his ideas of Swaraj and Swadesh. Gandhi's understanding of Swaraj as a complete republic is something outstanding. It is independence of its neighbors for its own vital wants, and yet interdependent for many others in which dependence is a necessary component. Swadeshi to him symbolizes all that is built in our own society, material and non-material. It is also understood as self-sufficiency. Gandhi's views on education lay more emphasis on training an individual for life and not to the classroom-based theoretical knowledge. He argued that education is not merely a means to achieve a status or earn money, but it should give freedom to an individual. In Gandhi's scheme of education, occasional training occupied the pride of place. Occasional training should be grounded in the needs of the community. So he stressed extensively on the on-hand real experiences that an individual would be gaining in a classroom. Let us now try to see and understand what Gandhi's views on education are in detail. Gandhi very clearly differentiated between literacy and education. By education, I mean all-around development, drawing out of the best in the child or man's body, mind and spirit, he said. Literacy, according to him, is neither the end of education nor even the beginning. It is one of the means through which men and women could be educated. He noted that literacy in itself is not education. To Gandhi, education is an instrument to attain equality. He very strongly spoke of the need for opening of educational opportunities for women and those who were denied access to education in Indian society. In his writings, Gandhi clearly displayed a holistic approach to education. These form the basis of his understanding of objective of education. While addressing the Congress workers, he noted that inclusion of Harijans into schools alone will not bring about change. He had indicated that hostels and schools should not segregate pupils on caste or class lines, but must function as inclusive institutions. Gandhi's values and vision of what constitutes a truly civilized and free India will help us understand his views on education. To him, education not only molds the new generation, but also reflects a society's fundamental assumptions about itself and individuals who compose it. Gandhi's experience in South Africa changed his outlook on politics. It also helped him to see the role of education that was playing in that particular struggle. He was aware of the fact that he had been a beneficiary of Western education, and for a number of years while he was in South Africa, he tried to persuade Indians to take advantage of it. However, Gandhi's ideas on Western education changed tremendously after his return to India, where he realized that Indian situations require a different type of education. As an alternative to the existing system of education that had many anomalies, Gandhi proposed a scheme of free education for all. This initial idea found ground in many of his articles and appeared in Harijan, which he called as Wardha scheme of education. These articles started to churn a lot of debate among educators. It later developed into the Wardha scheme of basic education. The Wardha scheme of education, popularly known as basic education, occupies a unique place in the field of elementary education in India. This scheme was the first attempt to develop an indigenous scheme of education in British India by Gandhi. As a nationalist leader, he fully realized that the British system of education could not serve the socio-economic need of the country. The Wardha conference led to a series of discussions on the need for reworking the education policy. This led to the appointment of a committee under the chairmanship of Dr. Zakir Hussain to prepare a detailed education plan and syllabus on the lines of the resolution taken during the Wardha conference. The committee submitted its reports in two phases, and this report is even today considered the fundamental document on basic education and continues to be known as the Wardha scheme of education. These reports were approved by Gandhi, who was the chair of the conference. The Wardha scheme of education was placed before the Indian National Congress at its Haripur session held in March 1938. In Gandhi's perception, Nayi Talim curriculum aimed at preparing a good society, not just a literate and or educated one. Seen from the context of an education system specially developed for a newly born democratic nation, it can be said that Nayi Talim aimed to fructify education that gave freedom from ignorance, literacy, superstition, psyche of servitude, and many more taboos that inhibited free thinking of a free India. In Gandhiji's words and vision, Nayi Talim was aimed at becoming the spearhead of a silent social revolution. The range of teaching tools that Gandhi prescribed to actualize Nayi Talim were as revolutionary and unconventional as the concept itself. For holistic development of body, mind and soul, he first emphasized useful and purposeful physical labor. The mind is a part of body, and so are hands, legs, torso and spine. If the mind develops at the cost of the rest of the body, it would be too a horrible situation, a callous. Moreover, it would result in uncoordinated growth, and that is not what Gandhi wanted India to become, a nation of strong minds and weak bodies, or vice versa. With the addition of heart or soul, the mind, body, soul combined completes Gandhi's vision of an inclusive, coordinated education. Handicrafts, art and drawing are the most fundamental teaching tools in Nayi Talim pedagogy. Herein, their function is not visualized too literally as a cottage industry vocation, but as a means of engaging young minds in a learning technique that is time-proven, informal, unstressed and full of ageless wisdom. Spinning and weaving, which can be aptly deduced to spinning khadi, were Gandhi's favorite techniques for implementing Nayi Talim. Gandhi felt that this pattern facilitated faster learning. One imparts 10 times as much in this manner as by reading or writing. Gandhi expressed the view that it was much more economical to impart learning through handicrafts than through classroom lessons. The Nayi Talim pedagogy thus sought to create free and enlightened individuals who would then constitute a good society, not just a free country. Gandhi's ideas of 3 H's and 3 R's make greater sense in the background of his philosophy of Nayi Taaleem pedagogy. The 3 H's that Gandhi talked about are hand psychomotor domain skill, heart spiritual domain skill, head cognitive domain or skill. The 3 R's that he wanted to enmesh with his idea of 3 H's are reading, writing and arithmetic. To Gandhi, learning only from books without linking the knowledge to our lives was a wasteful activity. He therefore insisted that every child or an youngster should be trained through a combination of hand, head and heart. Gandhi wanted that the learning experience must be based on what one does, use of hand, think what is needed, application of mind or head, and putting oneself into the action, that is heart. To him, when these ets and r's are balanced, we could say that the person is educated as it builds a healthy personality. Gandhi was of the view that through education we need to teach youngsters certain ideals which would help them to be good citizens, and through activities students are in a position to think on practical lines. This approach leads to character building. Gandhi's perception of education encompasses the head, heart and hands, thus leading to the all-around development of a child. Further, Gandhi conceptualizing a comprehensive new training, Samagra Nayi Taaleem, placed the same before the nation. This led to organizing a conference of education ministers, educational workers, and here the Samagra Nayi Taaleem was fine-tuned. This conference took important resolution which impacted the quality of basic education in different provinces. A clear understanding and implementation strategies of basic education finally emerged after a decade of experimentation and discussion. The Samagra Nayi Taaleem laid down the following: free, universal and compulsory education should be provided to all boys and girls between the ages of 7 and 14 years. Education should be imparted in the mother tongue of the child. All education should center on some basic craft chosen with due regard to the capacity of the child and the need of the locality. This craft must not be taught mechanically, but its social and scientific implications are to be studied side by side. In this craft-centered education, all the subjects to be taught were to be integrally integrated and related to the selected craft or the child's physical and social environment. Gandhi placed the highest premium on basic education and gave maximum number of lectures on how we need to internalize the need for basic education. In the following section, we are going to look into some of his ideas on basic education, which he called Bunyadi Shiksha. The ancient saying, education is that which liberates, is as true today as it was before. Education here does not mean mere spiritual knowledge, nor does liberation signify only spiritual liberation after death. Knowledge includes all training that is useful for the service of mankind, and liberation means freedom from all manners of servitude, even in the present life. Slavery is of two kinds: slavery to domination from outside and one's own artificial needs. The knowledge acquired in the pursuit of this ideal alone constitutes true study, according to Gandhiji. Education to Gandhi was the space where persistent questioning and healthy inquisitiveness are encouraged to acquire knowledge of any kind. He also refers to the attitude of and the state of mind of the learner. Inquisitiveness should be tempered by humility and respectful regard for the teacher, and not degenerate into impudence. Insolence, Gandhi noted, is the enemy of the receptivity of mind. To him, knowledge should always be accompanied by humility and will to learn. At the primary education level, According to Gandhi, children should be given elementary knowledge of history, geography, mental arithmetic, and art of spinning. Through these, he proposes to develop their intelligence. He felt that the commencement of training by teaching the alphabet and reading and writing hampers their intellectual growth. The alphabet has to be taught only after they have acquainted themselves with the conditions and history of the society in which they live. Gandhi's instance on autonomy and self-regulation is reflected in his ideas on informal education. His conception of social education was concerned with learning that was generated within everyday life. This is in fact the basis on which informal educators work. It was also an education focused on the individual but relied on cooperation between individuals. This leads to a relationship between educator and student and or learners. Gandhi's dream was to impart primary education through the medium of village handicrafts like spinning, which would, according to him, spearhead a silent social revolution laden with most far-reaching consequences. This form of education, Gandhi felt, would provide a healthy and moral ground for a sound rural-urban relationship. He felt that this method would help in addressing the existing social insecurity and unequal relationship between the classes. It will check the progressive decay of our villages and lay the foundation of a more just social order in which there is no unnatural division between the haves and the have-nots, and everybody is assured of a living wage and the right to freedom. Gandhi extensively spoke about the medium of instruction. Gandhi was totally opposed to English education. His distance towards English education is evident in his writing. He wrote, "The rottenness of this education, and that to give millions knowledge of English, is to enslave them, that by receiving English education we have enslaved the nation." Gandhi was upset that he had to speak of home rule or independence in what was clearly a foreign language that he could not practice in court in his mother tongue. That all official documents were in English, as were all the best newspapers, and that education was carried out in English for the chosen few. Gandhi attaches greatest importance to learning in the language into which a child is born. He notes that English is today admittedly the world language. "I would therefore accord it a place as a second optional language, not in the school but in the university course. We and our children must build on our own heritage." Gandhi noted that by borrowing from another, we impoverish our own. His stress was on building knowledge in the language spoken by people. "I want the nation to have the treasures contained in that language, and for that matter in other languages of the world, through its own vernaculars into Indian languages." Bringing knowledge from across the world and from within the country was to be addressed by good translations. Gandhi's radical alternative to colonial education is something which stands out very specifically. As we have seen, Gandhi had not only rejected colonial education but also put forward a radical alternative. To understand the alternative system he proposed, we need to understand his disposition towards industrialization, which was centric to Western education. Gandhi, through his writings and lectures, has expressed his absolute opposition to modern machinery. In his collected works, he refers to machinery as having impoverished India, and that it was difficult to measure the harm that Manchester has done to them by producing machine-made cloth, which in turn ruined the internal market for locally produced hand-woven goods. He writes about the conditions of women working in the mills of Bombay and made the point that before they were introduced, these women were not starving. Thus, his idea of education to a great extent emerged from the realities of Indian society and insisted on supporting Swadeshi and attainment of home rule. Within this context of the need for a machineless society, Gandhi developed his ideas on education. The core of his proposal was the introduction of productive handicrafts in the school curriculum. The idea was not simply to introduce handicrafts as a compulsory school subject, but to make the learning of a craft the centerpiece of the entire teaching learning program. It implied a radical restructuring of the sociology of school knowledge in India, where productive handicrafts had been associated with the lowest groups in the hierarchy of the caste system. Knowledge of the production process involved in crafts such as spinning, weaving, leatherwork, pottery, metalwork, basket making, and bookbinding had been the monopoly of specific caste groups in the lowest stratum of the traditional social hierarchy. Many of them belong as considered untouchables. India's own tradition of education, as well as the colonial education system, had emphasized skills such as literacy and acquisition of knowledge, of which the upper caste had a monopoly on. The social philosophy and the curriculum of what Gandhi called basic education thus favored the child belonging to the lowest stratum of society to understand and learn and participate in other crafts developed by the upper stratums too. By doing so, it implied a program of social transformation. It sought to alter the symbolic meaning of education and to change the established structures of opportunities for education. The motivation for Gandhi to propose the introduction of productive handicrafts into the school system was for these institutions to be self-supporting to the extent possible. There were two reasons as to why he gave a pride of place to handicrafts. First, a poor society such as India simply could not afford to provide education for all children unless the schools could generate resources from within. Second, the more financially independent the schools are, the more politically independent they would be. What Gandhi wanted to avoid was dependence on the state, which he felt could mean interference from the center. Above all, Gandhi valued self-sufficiency and autonomy. These were vital for his vision of an independent India made up of autonomous village communities to survive. It was the combination of Swaraj and Swadesh that he visualized as the framework in which the education system functioned. A state system of education within an independent India would have been a complete contradiction as far as Gandhi was concerned. Gandhi constantly talked about equality in work. He was of the opinion that manual work should not be treated as something inferior to mental work. He held the view that the work of the craftsmen or laborers should be the ideal model for good life. Schools which were based on people-centric productive work, which would serve the cause of society and create a whole person in whose personality a semblance would be achieved between mind, body, and spirit. Gandhi, in his talks on education, very vociferously brought out the role of the teachers. In his educational plan, Gandhi assigned autonomy to the teacher in the management of the daily curriculum of the school. He wanted to free the Indian teacher from interference from outside, particularly government or state bureaucracy. A teacher who established rapport with the taught becomes one with them, learns more from them than he actually gives. Gandhi used to say, "He who learns nothing from his disciple is, in my opinion, worthless. Whenever I talk with someone, I learn from them. I take from them more than I give to them." In this way, a true teacher regards themselves as students of their students. If you will teach your pupil with this attitude, you will benefit much more from them, was his statement to teachers. To conclude, we can say that To Gandhi, education that aims at moulding the pupil as a whole person rather than concentrating on one aspect of his or her personality is real education. He viewed education as a highly moral activity. Gandhi envisaged a nation where the citizens would be imbibed and who would be imbibing in their formative stages five human values that would create a just and equitable and moral society. These five human values that Gandhi envisaged came to be known as National Panchsheel when it was included in the National Policy on Education. These values are cleanliness, truthfulness, hard work, equality, and cooperation. Gandhi's thoughts on education assume enormous significance in the light of the major shifts that are taking place both in the context and management of education in the liberalizing era of today.